Hello everyone, my name is Siddharth and we are in the final module of the Sustainable E-Waste Management training, online training. So let me just share my screen with you and then maybe we can start. Yeah, so I hope everyone can see my screen right now. And like I mentioned, today we are here to discuss about the opportunities and circular economy potential in e-waste management. So we had spoken at length about the challenges that we are facing with respect to e-waste management. And these challenges are in the form of authorization or locating or finding producers and recyclers who have not gained authorization or are not following environmental sound management techniques for dealing with e-waste. Apart from that, there are also challenges with respect to channelization and collection of e-waste. There is also a very huge problem of inventorization. There is also a problem of informalization of the e-waste management, right? So, but at one side of the coin, if you look at all these challenges, the other side of the coin also has a lot of opportunities to offer, right? Because e-waste is a stream that is valued at $62.5 US billion, right? Now that's a huge amount of resource that we are just wasting away. So let us just quickly run through the opportunities that we have. So we had discussed that as consumers, it is up to us to channelize the e-waste in the right direction and ensure that they are reaching facilities where environmental sound techniques are being used to treat them, right? So the first thing that we will discuss about here is reevaluate, right? So what do I mean when I say reevaluate? Is basically if I have a friend who or a colleague who has, you know, just bought a new mobile phone or maybe a new gadget that I'm very fascinated by, I get this very strong craving or this desire that, you know, I should also own something like that. Now, you need to stop and you have to ask yourself the question, do you really need it? Because as we are advancing, there are a lot of things like fast food, right? And there is also fast fashion. Like you just wear it for a certain amount of time and then you just dispose it without thinking where is that disposed product going, right? It does not go away. It does not vanish. It is somewhere there, not at your house or not at your place, but it definitely is somewhere there, right? So you need to ask yourself this question, do you really need it? And these products also come with kind of, you can say, a status symbol, right? So you have to ensure that you are not investing in things that you do not need, right? So that is the first thing. And even if you are investing, if you finally give into the craving of, you know, buying or investing into that new product, you have the option of extending the life of your electronics, right? Or rather, you can donate it to someone who might need it more than you do, or you can, you know, just pass it on to a friend or a relative who might use that product, right? Maybe you're not using it. So basically, giving the product a second life, a third life, that is what it actually matters, right? Apart from that, if we talk about extending the life of our electronics, we have to be sure that, you know, whenever we talk about repairing, there's always this second cost involved that, you know, if I pay maybe 1,000 or 2,000 rupees more, I will get a brand new product. So why not spend those extra 1,000, 2,000 rupees and get a new product instead of investing on your old product? So that is a mindset that needs to change. We need to repair, right? Because when you throw away your electronic equipment, at the same time, you are also throwing away a lot of resources, a lot of money that has went into, you know, manufacturing it or the raw materials that have been mined, the water, the energy, and the chemicals that have been used to you know, get the product together, right? So apart from this, what we can do is we can identify. Now you need to research, you need to find out about producers who are responsibly manufacturing their products, or who use environmental friendly electronics, or whose presence in the market is in such a way that they are trying to build awareness about the different kinds of electronic equipment and the products and the e-waste that is getting generated, right? And the last but not the least is definitely reuse. Reuse large electronics, create a network wherein you can, in your own locality, you can kind of find people who are in need of equipment that you might not be needing anymore. So this brings me to the point of 3 R's. So opportunities are always there, and especially if we are talking with respect to waste management, they also they always come in the form of 3 R's, which I am sure all of you might be aware of: reduce, reuse, and recycle. Right? Now, it is very important that you use these 3 terms in the exact same order. Right? First, that you have to do is you have to reduce. You have to reduce your own consumption. You have to reduce the amount of waste that you are throwing away, or even for that matter, the amount of waste that you are generating. Right? Apart from the reduce part, this is definitely the first. You can and should reduce your consumption. The second one is reuse. You should always go for a reuse. If you are not a very tech savvy person, or you do not intend to waste a lot of money on new products, you can always go for a second hand products. Now we have all the major players like Amazon and Flipkart, they are venturing into this second hand market. Amazon has this portal called Amazon Renew, which only sells second hand or refurbished products, right? So a lot of major players are also venturing out into this particular segment. And the second R is something that is you should definitely follow, that is reuse. And the third is definitely recycle. But you have to keep in mind that when we recycle, we are again putting in a lot of resources in the form of energy, water, and chemicals to recycle a particular product. It does not recycle itself. It is not a natural process. It is a process that is man-made and has to be resource, and it is actually resource intensive, right? Sorry. So let's move on to the next slide, wherein we will talk about the flow of e-waste. So this is the natural or the regular flow of e-waste that we have right now. Most of the nations are following this particular flow when it comes to e-waste, right? So the very first stage is the generation stage. If you recollect, we had discussed in module 1 about the sources of e-waste. Now definitely the sources are nothing but manufacturer, producers, and a very considerable part of the source is also imports, right? So this is where it all is generated, all of it is generated. The next level is the market sales, wherein the products are manufactured and they are out in the market for people or consumers to buy them and take them back at their place. So market sales, basically they can be in the form of businesses, dealers, retailers, governments, right? After the market phase is over, it comes to the consumption phase, where people or entities like households, businesses, like MNCs, multinational companies or governments, banks, ministries, they consume these kind of products, right? Now, once we have this over here, all the products which are faulty and in and fall under warranty are returned back to the dealers or the retailers, and the dealers and retailers in turn give it back to the generators or the producers, right? And most of the products are not faulty, and they are consumed by people like us, and ultimately, when we are done using the product, or the product has reached the end of its life, we throw it away, and then that is where it starts to be referred as e-waste, right? So the e-waste generation, e-waste generation is done by the consumers, right? So we generate the e-waste, and a lot of a very good part of the e-waste that we generate is actually a lot of components or spare parts or consumables are still in working form, which can be taken out, which can be removed, extracted from that particular product, and they can be channelized back into the market for resale or for refurbishment, right? And the e-waste generated can be then sent for processing, which can be processed by using environmentally sound technologies. And then finally, we can have the end products, and we can sort what needs to be sent out for disposal and what needs to be incorporated back into the value chain. Now, when I use the word value chain, let me just help you to understand what exactly is the value chain, what exactly value chain is all about, right? So here we have four different pillars. That is, one is the generation, the second one is the collection, third is the treatment, and the fourth one is the output, right? So in the generation, again, we are talking about majorly the sources of e-waste, right? So the production and the e-waste import that we have, both of it comes under the generation. After the consumption phase by the consumers, the e-waste is basically collected, transported, and sorted, and then it reaches treatment facilities wherein it is dismantled, shredded to make further transportation much easier, so that high quantities of valuable material or resources can be transported for secondary processing. After the secondary processing, what we have is secondary raw materials like plastic, which can be definitely sent to plastic manufacturing companies, which can use them and incorporate them in their products. We also have a lot of metals which are very high in value, which can again be used in multiple applications. What we need to understand here is the e-waste import that is coming is not being used or being consumed by the people or the consumers, right? It directly goes for the treatment. After the collection point, it directly goes for treatment, wherein it is depolluted, dismantled, and shredded. And then a very considerable part of that directly goes to the landfill, right? Things which cannot be used further, or things which are of no value to the recycler or to or the further value chain or the further stakeholders in the value chain, they have to be sent out to landfill or to transport, storage, and disposal facilities, which we call as TSDFs, right? So after the shredding and the dismantling part, a lot of resources are also generated, which can be reused. So the output is in the form of three things, which is the secondary raw materials. These can be glass, this can be metals, or this can also be plastic. The reuse, so which basically means that the components or the consumable or the spare parts can directly be reused, right? For consumption, or it goes to the producer or the manufacturer who directly uses that product in his who directly uses those consumables in his new product, and then they can be sent out for further consumption. And the last one is definitely the landfill or the disposal facility. So this is the value chain. Now let us have a look at who are the key stakeholders who are included in the different value chain of this particular flow of e-waste. So actors in the e-waste recycling value chain. So in the generation phase, for the production part, a lot of domestic manufacturers are involved. For the import part, a lot of manufacturing companies and producers are involved, or original equipment manufacturers, as we can call them. For the consumption part, households and businesses and bulk consumers, government institutions are involved, right? In the collection phase, which involves, or the channelization phase, as I can refer to it as. So basically in the channelization phase, collection, transportation, and sorting, and the stakeholders or the actors that are involved in this particular phase are informal e-waste collector, formal collectors and some independent waste pickers, right? In the treatment phase, when I come to the treatment phase, a lot of different actors come into play, like scrap dealers or dismantlers and recyclers. They may be informal or they may be formal recycling companies. So and this is basically these are no other than the stakeholders that we have already discussed in the past two modules, module one and module two, right? And then finally we have the output, which can have two outcomes, right? One, they can either be sent out to the landfill for disposal, and the second outcome is that they can be reused either as components or consumables in new product, or the product in itself as a whole can be reused, right? So this was about the value chain. Now coming to the circular economy potential of e-waste. So when we talk about circular economy, we have always heard about this term circular economy and plastic being a waste stream which is very highly talked about. You must have heard about how plastic recycling and circular economy can go hand in hand, right? But then when we are talking about e-waste, circular economy is something that makes even more sense, right? The only reason is that e-waste is very less talked about, is that out of the total solid stream of waste that is generated, e-waste is only 2% of the total solid stream. But it represents over 70% of the hazardous components or components that are disposed of in the landfill, right? So it only makes much more sense to adopt a circular economy or a circular approach when we are talking about electronics, right? So after this, let me also tell you a fact that around 60 elements out of the 118 elements in the periodic table can be found in electronic components that we use on a regular basis. So just imagine the amount of resource that can be recovered from these equipment that me and you are using, and then we just discard it without giving it a second thought of where it will land up and how it will pollute kind of impact the environmental and the social well-being of people around us, right? So let us just talk about the circular vision for electronics. So it starts at the design phase or the manufacturing phase. So majorly producers have to keep in mind that they design their product in such a way that has a higher durability. It has a higher reuse and repair coefficient, and they also need to make sure that it is safe for recycling, and all the hazardous substances that have to be used while you are manufacturing an electronic product can be considerably reduced, right? So overall, in the design phase, these are some pointers that you need to keep in mind, or rather the producers have to keep in mind when they are strategizing on how new products have to be made. So in the module 2, you might have heard about design for sustainability, right? This is where it all boils down to, and this is where we can start. This is the starting point. This is where it will all make a difference, right? So even during the manufacturing process, even if I have designed my product for sustainability or designed my product for durability, there, like, waste is inevitable, right? So it definitely will be generated. So all the scrap that is generated has to be reintegrated into the manufacturing process, and all the waste material that is generated has to be somehow, you have to come up with strategies to involve or incorporate all that back into either your own product, or you have to find people for whom your waste might be valuable, and then you can just channelize your waste to those particular entities. so that they also have to incur less cost, and the overall idea becomes successful for circular economy, right? Now, as we move from the manufacturing stage into the use phase, this is where the consumer comes into picture, right? So when the consumer is in charge, or he has the product in his custody, then the consumer has to rethink twice or thrice before, you know, just discarding of the waste in a domestic bin, right? So we as consumers have to make sure that we are extending the life of the product. Even when I think that the product that I am currently using is of no use to me, I have to just take that effort to, you know, look in my circles if there is someone who I know personally or through someone else who might be in need of this particular equipment. And what that will do is basically it will help to increase the life of that particular electronic equipment, right? So giving the electronic equipment a second life, a third life, will basically go a long way in meeting this circular economy potential, right? Now we also need to take into account that any equipment that can be repaired, we should and we must get it repaired, right? We should not go for new electronic products just because of the status symbol or due to some marketing gimmicks that is used by the producer companies or advertising agencies, right? You have to use your brains, and then you have to invest in new products. That's an appeal that I would like to make, right? Now, irrespective of if you give a second life or a third life, however durable the product is, or how irrespective of the number of times that you repair the product, it is bound to reach its end of life, right? What you can do as a consumer is you can extend the life of the product from maybe say a 3-year time to a 7-year time, which is a very good feat to achieve, right? But ultimately it will reach the end of its life. So this is where the authorities have to come into picture, all the ULBs, all the pollution control boards, the pollution control committees. They have to come here and they have to ensure how to achieve a higher product collection rate, and how to make sure that more and more people or more number of consumers come and they deposit their waste at a certain point, right? Which, and this can only happen if you incentivize this particular collection process, and it is a step that can only be taken by the authorities, right? So this is somewhere that the authorities can play a very vital role. After the end of life of the product, it has to be collected and it has to be sourced to a formal recycler who is ensuring that they are using environmentally sound technologies and techniques to treat the e-waste, and that they can extract efficiently the highest possible amount of resources from the waste that is entering their facilities. For this, what we need is advanced infrastructure and basically policies that encourage the recycling sector to collect more waste and extract more value out of the waste that we are collecting, right? So if you overall have a look at this circular economy potential, it is not just about one stakeholder, right? All the stakeholders, right, from the producers, the authorities, the consumers, and the recyclers, dismantlers, all of them have to come together, and they have a very small part to play in the overall bigger puzzle that we have over here, right? So this is regarding the circular economy potential of e-waste per se, right? So moving on to the next slide, we will just discuss the way forward or the road ahead, and what are the different strategies that we can adopt while we move ahead from here. So the first one is definitely the buyback and the return system. We do definitely have a lot of buyback and return schemes, but they do not offer us a very lucrative amount when it comes to buyback, right? So you would rather want to keep that product back in your drawer and not give it to someone who is just offering you peanuts for your product, right? That's the mentality that we have, and it's a fact. So we should have functional buyback and return systems wherein people should feel like, yes, they should go to the buyback scheme, wherein I can also be rest assured that the product that I have used is not causing any kind of pollution to the environment, or it is not causing any health hazard in the society, right? The next one is definitely having a closed loop and an advanced recycling. Closed loop is basically we have to plug all the gaps that we have in the collection system or in the channelization system. And we need to adopt environmentally sound management of e-waste, right? Producers have to ensure that the products that they are placing in the market are very highly durable. And the repair for those products or the service that they provide has to be at a price that is justified. And the cost of repair should not almost be equal to the cost of the new product, right? A lot of us would have faced things like this. When my phone is not working fine, I just go to a service center and he will tell, he will quote a cost that is almost equivalent to the cost that I bought the new equipment for, which does not make sense, right? So you have to ensure that your repair costs are kept considerably lower, which will kind of incentivize or encourage the consumers to go for repair rather than for investing in new products. The next one is urban mining. So as you might be aware that mines are almost the most highest generators of CO2, right? So urban mining is a concept which basically all the e-waste that we are collecting, if we manage somehow to collect it at one place, or rather at multiple places in a city or in a ULB, it can be used as a very good resource for extracting a lot of valuable components out of it. And it can be done at a very low price without emissions of carbon dioxide or any other emissions that happen. By using less resources like water, chemicals, and energy. So this is an area which definitely needs to be looked into, and it has a lot of potential if done in the right way. The next one is reverse logistics. So there is a very good channel if you actually see that the producers launch their product, it reaches a dealer or a retailer, and from there it reaches the consumer, right? Now the same logistic pattern should also work in a backward direction, right? Which is what is known as reverse logistics, that we have to plug all the leakages that we have in the reverse logistics system so that from the consumer, it can either go back to the retailer or somehow it can directly reach to the producer or the recycler who is tied up with the producer in a certain way. Right? So the reverse logistics are also a very important part when it comes to collection, channelization, and sound e-waste management in the country. Now, as I leave, I would want to leave you with a food for thought. So this last point that we have here is electronics as a service. A very good analogy for this or an example for this is the Ola cars or the Uber cars that we have, right? So earlier, if you wanted to travel in day-to-day life in a car, you would have to invest in a car, right? But now the scenario is different. You do not need to own a car. What you need to do is you just need to rent a car to move from point A to point B. And what you are paying is just for that particular trip, right? Now, electronics as a service is a concept that is catching up in a few Western countries, which basically means that I, as a consumer, do not have to invest or buy a product. I can only ensure that I can only go to a producer and ask for a product which I can rent. I do not have to buy the product, right? So it is a win-win situation. If you have an overall picture of this particular thing, it is a win-win situation for everyone. Why? I will tell you. Because the producers, if they are making products which are durable, let's say now they are, because they do not have to deal with the waste that is being generated from the consumers, and they are making products that will last only for, let's say, 3 years or 5 years. When the onus of disposing of that particular product is placed on the producer in the form of a service that he has to provide, he will ensure, he or she or they will ensure that, you know, they make their product durable. They will also ensure that their product is durable, because the more durable it is, the more money they will be able to extract from it over a period of more number of years that it is in service, right? For the consumer does not have to pay a one-time cost to actually, you know, procure the product. What he can do is he will pay out very less amount of money to kind of hold the product in his custody, in his or her custody. And then whenever he or she feels that, yeah, I am done using this product, I do not want this product, maybe I should upgrade this equipment, can just pass the used electronic to the producer, who can then rent it out to some other consumer who wants a product of that category, right? So it is a win-win situation for everyone. And then when the electronics reach finally the end of their life, these producers should have a tie-up with recyclers so that the end-of-life product is sent directly to the recyclers without the consumer being involved in the overall process, right? So electronics is a service that electronics as a service is something that you can read about. I have also attached a document which at length tells about electronics as a service, and you will also be able to find a lot of details once you go online, right? So that's all from my side for now, and I hope that the learning that you had in this particular online training course was fruitful and you found it useful. I would request all of you to give your feedback regarding this particular course, and we would be very happy to get in touch with you and make any changes in the program that we have designed for you. Thank you so much for your time and support.